So, hello students, good morning everyone. Now, today we are going to deal with third part of this topic. Till now, we have seen that events, tries and O level, which is written by Colin Dexter, is a topic about a criminal, Evans, who had already broke out through jail earlier 3 times. And maybe this is the 4th attempt by him. He decided to give German O-level exam and took coaching privately in the jail for 6 months. On the other side, governor of the prison is responsible to conduct the smooth functioning of the exam and to see that no chance should be taken by Evans for the means of escape during the exam. Here, Mr. Jackson and Mr. Stephens have been looking after the arrangement for the exams under governor's order. McCleary is an invigilator for exam. He is church minister. Almost all the precautions are taken by governor and his officer. Now, up till now we have seen that exam had already started 10 minutes late and there were some conversation which were heard by the governor at 9:25 a.m. where McCleary instructs to fill up the details in the answer sheet which we have seen in the last video. Suddenly, now governor gets a call from examination board and assistant secretary of special languages talk to him about some corrections. And here governor gets stuck and he tries whether he realizes and he does not understand whether the call is real or fake. So we had done this much and we stopped there and now we will move forward. Okay, so let's see now further what he does. He tries to cross check the phone as who had called. So he calls at examination board, but what happens, the phone was engaged. And now suddenly, 2 minutes later, he heard some whispered communication in the cell again. So McCleary's broad Scottish voice. Now McCleary is very specialist in Scot language, and so now what he speaks is, "Will you please stop writing every while, Mr. Evans? Listen carefully." So here you can understand that he is trying to speak in a Scottish accent. We don't know to speak in such a way, but we'll try. So what is that? He further says that candidates offering German 0211 should note the following correction. On page 3, line 15, the fourth word should read as goldenen, not goldenee. And the phrase will therefore read as zum goldenen loven, not zum goldeni loven. I will repeat that, zum goldenen loven, not zum goldeni loven. So these are the words which are told by McCleary to Evans. That was the correction. Now all this governor had listened and he records the agreements of German adjectives which he had learned in 6th grade. So he tries to recall that what it is, and then he realized that that is the adjective. So McCleary's accent was quite impressive, but what about Evans, governor thinks. And so he talked to himself, was he able to understand his accent? So here our students just try to remember that the first call which governor got was very very important. Why this all things you will come to know later on, but the phone calls whichever governor gets in between are the hint somewhere to find that what Evans have thought about. Now here further you can see, now the phone rings again from magistrate's court. Now what do you mean by magistrate's court? That is a lower level court which handles the criminal cases. Now here further they needed a prison van and a couple of prison officers. Why? Because it was a remand case. Now what is remand case? A remand case is a case from the lower court, the case goes to the higher court, and then again the higher court send that case back to the lower court. So that is called remand case. So that type of case was there, and so government gets a call, and that call was from magistrate's court. Now here once again governor wondered whether that could be a hoax. So he thinks that is someone trying to befool him, or he's trying to fool him. But then he thought to be very silly and stupid. Then he says, Evans. Nothing else is there in his mind. On the other hand, Stephens, who is doing his duty very properly and very keen observation he is doing. And so what he did, he peered through the peephole at the interval of 1 minute. And after a long time, then he started peeping once again after 2 minutes. Till 10:45 a.m. things were all right. Evans had kept his pen in his lips, sitting in front of him, and McCleary was seated opposite, slightly askew. Askew means little bit crossed, so you can see in the picture. And his face was semi-profile, and his hair amateurishly. What do you mean by amateurishly? Means it was not so good. It was improper. It was cut in an unskillful way. That was very close to his skull. And what he was doing, he was just reading the newspaper, the Church Time. So all these settings are given. So whenever Stephens used to observe McCleary and Evans, he has seen that Evans had always kept the pen in his mouth. Now further, we can see, once again it is told that at 10:50 a.m. the receiver crackled. And the governor realized that he had almost forgotten Evans for a few minutes. Now Evans was whispering, please sir, and then please sir. So Evans, would you mind if I put a blanket round my shoulders, sir? It's a bit parky in here, isn't it? Then there's silence. Evans told that the blanket was on his bunk. And so McCleary replied once again, okay, be quick about it. And then there was silence once again. Now at 10:51, Stephens was little bit surprised to see a grey regulation blanket which was tied around, and his pen was still between, means Evans' pen was still between his teeth, and he was staring as he was staring before. Now here Stephen thought to report as slightly irregularity, and Jackson had also said him to inform if something goes fishy. So Stephens looked through the peephole once again. So he saw that the Evans had pulled the dirty blanket more closely to himself, and he thought that he was planning to sudden leap like a batman and to suffocate McCleary in the blanket. So he thought that maybe he will hurt McCleary. But then he had another thought too. He thought as there was no sun available on this side, or maybe there was no heating during summer, maybe it would get quite chilled in some of the cells, in some of the rooms of the jail. And maybe he thought it is to be real. And so he decided to revert again to his earlier every minute observation and not to inform to anyone. Now, further, at 11:20 a.m. Now, what happens at 11:20 a.m.? The receiver crackled once more at governor's office, and then once again the silence was broke. Here, McCleary informed, only 5 minutes left. At 11:22 a.m., Jackson shouted along the corridor. The governor wanted to speak with him. So Stephens was informed to accompany McCleary to the main prison gates. That was informed by governor. Also, it was his duty to make sure that the door was locked on Evans after McCleary had left. So, two things governor had told him to do properly. What were those two things? One thing was that once the exams are over, he should accompany McCleary to main prison gate. And the second thing is that he should also see to it that Evans' door is locked properly. Now, at 11:25 a.m., Governor heard final exchanges. What they had discussed? McCleary says, "Stop writing, please." And then there is silence. McCleary says again, "Put your sheets in order and see they are correctly numbered." Then there is silence. Scrapping of the chairs and tables were heard. And then Evans says, "Thank you very much, sir." McCleary says, "All right, was it?" Evans, "Not too bad." McCleary says, "Good, Mr. Stephens." Further, the governor heard the door clang for the last time, and this way he understood that the examination was over. Stephen asked McCleary about Evans' exams while walking beside McCleary to the main gates. When he was talking to him, he asked, "Och, I cannot think has distinguished himself. I'm afraid." So his Scots accent seemed broader than ever, and his long black overcoat reaching almost to his knees fostered the illusion that he had suddenly grown slimmer. See, try to understand these sentences. These are very important. You will understand it later on. So here what he says is that McCleary says that he feels that Evans have not done better, and his Scottish whatever accent was there, it was quite broader than he was speaking. It was more finely he was speaking now. And then his overcoat when he came was different, means it was not reaching the knees, but now the overcoat was reaching the knees. And Stephens felt that somewhere McCleary was looking thinner than before. So while returning back from the gate, he decided once again to take just a glance at Evans. So Stephens, here you can see one sentence is given here. Stephens is compared to a woman who couldn't convince herself to check for the door for 15 to 20 times. Maybe it happens with your mothers. Whenever they go out, they always try to check. Even though they have done that work, they try to check it many times whether that work is done or not. Same thing happened with Stephen. So he was not able to believe whether he has closed Ivan's door properly or not. So he thought that instead of taking a coffee, he thought to take one more glance on Ivan's, and then so he went to see the Evans. Now here, as he re-entered, the D-Wing went to Evans' cell and he opened the peephole. Suddenly, Stephen shouted, "Oh no, Christ, no!" There was a man sprawled back in Evans' chair, and for semi-second, Stephen thought it must be Evans. As a grey blanket was slipping from his shoulder, the front closely cropped irregular tufted hair, fierce red blood that had dripped already through the black beard and spread into the white clerical collar and down into the black clerical front. So here, can you understand, students, that there is something fishy, something has gone wrong, and so Stephen shouted, and here somewhere he thought that he was Evans. But now further, let's see what he sees. And Stephen shouted so wildly for the Jackson. Now, as he was scared, he shouted, "Jackson!" And then when he shouted so loudly, means it was so loud that even though McCleary was totally, he was bleeding, it whispered, means those words had appeared in McCleary's ear. And McCleary was feeble. He was weak little bit because he had got hurt. He took out his handkerchief from his pocket, and that blood slipped slowly in that cloth also. He gave a long low moan, means he was silent, and then tried to speak, but his voice trailed away, means he couldn't speak very loud. Once Jackson arrived, he asked Stephens to ring the police and the ambulance. Now you can understand that there was chaos everywhere. And when Stephens returned back, McCleary's handkerchief was full, sticky and squelchy of blood. What do you mean by squelchy? See, you can see that something liquid, if you just dip the handkerchief in water, and if you squish that type of word, that is called squelchy. So the handkerchief was full of blood, and the drops of blood were falling down. And then further, McCleary slowly raised himself, his face twisted tightly with pain. Dina, where are ambulance man? I'm right. I'm all right. Get the police. I know where he is. While speaking, he closed his eyes and another drip of blood splashed like a huge raindrop on the wooden floor. Tip. He caught the question paper on the table and grabs it tightly. So while he was not well, he tried to find that question paper and he caught it very tightly. Get the governor. I know where the Ivans is, he told. Immediately, the sirens were sounding. There was sound of the sirens. Prison officers barked orders. Prisoners were puzzled and pushed their way along the corridors. Doors were banged and bolted. Phones were ringing everywhere. You can understand that what chaos would happen in the jail. Within a minute, McCleary with Jackson and Stephen supporting him, either side, was greeted in the prison yard by the governor. Perplexed and grim. Means governor was perplexed and grim. What do you mean by this? He was very, very confused and somewhere he was gloomy and he was sad because the things which had happened, he had never thought about. Now governor told, they must get McCleary to hospital immediately because McCleary was also hurt. So governor was having his responsibility as well. Now he was totally confused. You have called the police? He asked. Yes, they are on their way. But I'm all right. Look, hey. Awkwardly, he opened the German question paper. McCleary opened and then thrust it before the governor's face. He says, it's there. Do you see what I mean? The governor looked down and realized what McCleary was trying to tell him. A photocopied sheet that had been carefully and cleverly superimposed over the last page of the question paper. See, there are 4 to 5 pages, and if one more page superimposed, in the sense it is the same. Total same papers, so it was superimposed, and originally was the blank paper, and the last page, there are 5 to 6 pages, and the last page, on that one more plain page was superimposed. So you see that what have done governor, he says. You see what they have done governor. His voice trailed off again, dredging the layers of the long neglected learning. So here you can again understand that governor is recalling the things which he had almost forgotten. When he saw the paper, it was German paper, and dredging means recalling the things which he had almost forgotten, and there were the layers of the paper, and long neglected learning means the language which he had learned before many years, mostly which was almost forgotten, but then he tried to translate the German text before him. Now what is the, see what is given in your textbook is Sein sollen dem Scorn Vera Britain Plan Genu Folgen Der which is Zed Pew Punk is Dre Minuten War Ende Des Examis. So see, this all are from the German text, and as we all don't know, let us try to see the English version, what does it mean? So here what it is written, you must follow the plan already, something was written. The vital point in the time is 3 minutes before the end of the exam, but something. So here he is trying to get that what it is written. So he is trying to find that actually, because as he has almost forgotten the German language, so he is trying to translate it. So somewhere he understands that there is some plan, then the main important part of the plan is that the last 3 minutes of the exam. And then further it is written, don't hit him too hard. Remember, he is minister. So he tries to understand the translation. Then further, and don't overdo the Scots accent. When? So here you can understand that all these things governor tries to resemble that what is written in the question paper, superimposed question with the one more page of layer of the page, whatever the Ivans had kept, that was written in that. Now here, suddenly when he was reading, something happened. When governor stopped. Now why he stopped? Because a fast approaching siren wailed to its crescendo. What do I mean by this? Means somewhere he was able to listen the siren and it was coming very fast to his ears. So from slow to fast. So voice crescendo means voice increasing from lower to higher. So someone if is very far, you can listen it. You can listen the things, but it is very low sound. But as the things come approaching near and near, you can find it little bit higher. So such type of thing he heard, and then while reading he stopped. And then what happened? Detective Superintendent Carter swung himself outside. Means from that when the Superintendent Carter came out and he saluted governor from a white police car. What the hell is happening, sir? And he turned to McLeary. Oh, Christ, who has hit him? These things he had discussed with the governor. Further, McLeary cut across whatever explanation the governor might have given. So what happened? Governor was trying to say something he would have told, but suddenly before governor would have speak, McLeary spoke and he told, Elphick's way, officer. I know where Evans. He was breathing heavily and leaned for support against the side of the car. And the imprint of his hand was left tarnished crimson. So what his, as you all know that his hand was totally bleeding, means whole body had the stains of the blood, and as he touched the car, his whole hand imprint was left on his car, and the tarnished crimson means like red color. Here his blood is compared with that. In bewilderment, Carter looked to the governor for guidance. Means bewilderment means he was somewhere confused. And then Carter just looked at governor. Means he wanted to know that what governor suggest him. What? So governor said, take him with you if you think he will be all right. He is the only one who seems to know what is happening. Now Carter opened the back door and helped McLeary inside. And within the few seconds, the car leapt away in the spurt of gravel. Spurt of gravel is an idiom. It means that very fast it moved. And here, now we will try to end this part. For the story, we will try to continue in the next part. And that will be the last part of our topic. So many things are there, many twists and turns. So keep watching and try to understand all the sentences given in detail. Thank you.